Hello, everyone. So for the first decade of my career, I thought that we could code ourselves out of any problem. I was working on new open source programming languages, and we were actually looking at extending the way we write Java code to encompass business concepts with something called aspect oriented programming that then went into things like the Spring Framework and so on. And as I was doing that, I realized just how disconnected developers are from typical value streams. I started understanding how different open source projects operate and how different that is from how software scales, because we were taking on more and more enterprise customers using our technologies, using these new open source frameworks. So I got really interested in this and decided to do my PhD to study how professional developers work, how they use programming languages like Java, and really where the bottlenecks in their development are. And throughout that process, I had the stark realization, because I'd been working on a highly productive open source team. We were, you know, back in 99, we were using XP and other agile methodologies. We had continuous delivery set up. And I realized that as I studied the way that we worked and the way that enterprise organizations and enterprise developers worked, I was actually monitoring their daily work in their IDE through my PhD studies, that the productivity difference I was seeing was somewhere between 100 and 1,000x. Thousand times, that the way that we were able to deliver value for our own customers, well, our own users, open source users, was that much faster than I was seeing in enterprise. And I got to really wondering why. Why is that? Why did we have this amazingly fast feedback loop? Why is it that the open source projects used today, they're the underpinnings of your enterprise applications, are often built by 4 or 5 or 6 developers, whereas we've got all, you know, these thousands or tens of thousands of developers and organizations who are struggling to really scale and deliver at that rate. And so I started meeting with more and more IT leaders, more and more technologists, and learning basically where these bottlenecks were coming from, where these disconnects were. And from that, I started creating this thing called the Flow Framework to allow us to basically understand and spot and really measure the bottlenecks. And this Flow Framework is embodied in the book Project to Product. So Project Product is really about how we take a new look at connecting, at measuring, and at finding flow in software delivery, and how we move away from these vanity metrics. Like, I've got this nice vanity metric for the first part of my career where I wrote over 1 million lines of open source code that's still in use today. That's now switched over to this horrible vanity metric of over 1 million air miles traveled as I try to learn why it's so hard to get to that productivity in large-scale enterprise. And as I had all those meetings, because it actually truly was a valuable experience to me to meet with all those IT leaders, have those hundreds of meetings and be asking them questions, so how do you measure software delivery? Because we know it's kind of hard to improve things that we can't measure. What are you measuring as a leader, as a technologist, in terms of how you improve what you're delivering to your customers, to the business? Where is your bottleneck? Because of course, if we're ever going to improve, we have to improve at the bottleneck. That's the whole point of lean, of things like theory of constraints. If we're ever investing resources anywhere other than the bottleneck, chances are we're wasting our time. So I realized as I was having all these meetings that I was never getting a straight answer to any of these questions. No one had any confidence in what they were measuring. And I would ask every single CIO or tech executive I met with, where's your bottleneck? And I would never get a straight answer. And I realized that there was something fundamentally wrong with that. Developers tend to know, technologists tend to know where their bottleneck is. They know whether they're waiting. They know if they're constantly stuck on a code review, because the person doing the code reviews is the bottleneck for their team. And that's where they're waiting. So there's this really big disconnect between what technologists saw and the way that the business leaders responsible for investment looked at technology. And I realized that this was a pretty fundamental problem. And this took me back to my very first experience of seeing a massive flaw and disconnect between the way technologists measured and understood what they were doing and the way that the business side did. And this is back to Nokia. So for me, this is back to an experience on Blackfriar Road in 2007, where myself, my PhD supervisor, where I just finished my PhD, we founded TaskUp Technologies, and our first enterprise client was Nokia. And it was actually the Symbian group working on the Series 40, then the Series 60 operating systems. And they found, so during my PhD, I created this open source project called Eclipse Myelin to help connect developers to the value stream. It became a core part of Eclipse and of other IDEs, integrated development environments. And Nokia wanted to use this for their developers because they were creating one of the first large-scale rollouts of Scrum and large-scale uses of an agile tool. So Nokia had this very interesting realization, which had them double down on their agile toolchain, on their agile training, and they realized that software was going to become their bottleneck. So we all heard about the iPhone in 2007. They knew about it over a year before that, before any of us did. They realized that that was my phone back then, back in 2006, the Nokia 6300. They realized that they were amazing at producing and scaling production and managing production of these phones, but that the phones wouldn't be covered with beautiful stainless steel buttons. They would actually be covered by this large screen, this large capacitive touch screen. I think a lot of people were attributing the failure of Nokia as a failure to move more quickly to those screens. What I was seeing at the time, and reflecting back on it, is they couldn't create the software fast enough to fill those screens, right? They couldn't create the widget libraries. They had that Series 60 operating system, was too kludgy for this. And so they realized that software was their bottleneck, and they just doubled down on Enterprise Agile. They got the best consultants in the business. They got Ken Schwaber to help them scale Scrum. They got Dean Leffingwell in there, the father of the the Scaled Agile framework. They created a way of measuring how agile they were. So, and this is where things get interesting, but they created the Nokia test for agility. And the Nokia test for agility was how many people that trained on Scrum and how many people were using the actual tool chain. So as they were doing this, I realized that that kind of testing for agility had nothing to do with my sense of agility, right? My sense of agility was how quickly we were iterating on delivering business value to our customers, which, and to our users, which to me was just how many programming languages features we shipped that week to our user base. What I realized that Nokia was doing, because we were working less so with leadership at that time, we were working more with the actual engineering managers at the time, is that they were going through this agile transformation. Meanwhile, all of the developers and development teams saying, that's nice, these new tools are okay, the Scrum stuff seems interesting, has nothing to do with a bottleneck, right? This is not going to help us deliver an app store or deliver those widget libraries. And what I realized that they were doing is this local optimization of the value stream. So basically, they were training people on Scrum, they were giving them tools, but nothing was flowing faster end to end, because they were building on an architecture on the Symbian operating system that simply could not provide that kind of feature flow or those kinds of features, and all the technologists knew it. Right? In retrospect, we can actually read accounts of some of those technologists going straight to the board saying, if we don't re-architect and get rid of this tech debt, we will never deliver on these business goals. But of course, they were never given the chance to do that because they were just told to do more features, do more features, do more features on, again, a platform that couldn't support them. So this disconnect, this kind of information asymmetry between what the technologists knew and what the business was doing, actually, I think, was the major contributor to the demise of Nokia, right? It wasn't until Stephen Elop joined much later that he said they were on a burning platform, they would have to replatform, but at that point, it was just far too late. They had lost 99% of the value of the mobile business, the mobile market they had created. It was no longer theirs. And the most strange thing to me about this whole experience was that to the business, through this Nokia test for agility, everything was on track, right? The whole transformation, as it was being measured, was on track, was doing well. Meanwhile, everyone else knew things were going downhill, and there was this massive disconnect and asymmetry. And I realized through that point is that that the way they were measuring things, this false sense of confidence that the board, the CEO, the entire leadership had on the agile transformation, actually completely derailed this transformation. This disconnected these users of a different language that were never never addressed. And so here's another story. Now this is over a decade later, and this is a top 25 bank by revenue. They're on their third agile transformation. This time it's with DevOps, so it's going to succeed for sure. And I think DevOps is a really important component of transformations. We need that automation, those practices, but alone, again, it's probably not enough. And the fascinating thing about this transformation, and others have witnessed like it, is that just the sheer amount of funding and organizational endorsement for it. So this one has $1 billion US incremental budget, in addition to the multi-billion budget of this bank, right? We've got large banks out there who have 100,000 IT staff, right? These are extremely consequential changes. And any way in which you can increase productivity and value delivery actually has a tremendous impact on the business and in the end on the economy. Then I realized that the way that this was being measured, this transformation, was just completely foreign to me. You know, at that point, TaskStop, this was a few years back, and then we had 120, 130 people. We still didn't have our first project manager. And I realized that they're measuring everything with project management. So this became interesting to me because we never ever looked at our own value streams that way, so I just want to understand how they're doing it. And I was watching, and I was realizing that they're measuring everything as a set of activities rather than results, and that there wasn't a value metric present. That IT was this cost center, everything was managed to cost, and 2 years later, I'm doing the same kind of set of interviews as I did at Nokia, as I did during my PhD, and the answer is just complete consistency in interviewing both the people who remained and the people who got fired after this successful transformation, that IT is delivering even less to the business than before. So $1 billion spent, you know, I'm envisioning now on my flight back to Vancouver, $1 billion gone up in flames because the transformation was successful and IT is delivering less to the business than it was before. And I realized that by the way it was measured, it truly was successful because the only thing that was measured was the cost reduction and whether the project plans were met. And then the only way that the IT delivery was being measured anyway was project plans. So I realized there's just something so fundamentally flawed with not having any measure of value, but only having a measure of activity through those project plans and Gantt charts and a measure of cost that completely derailed this because it actually had them create software architectures that would never scale to the bank globally, as one example, right? IT did this for IT, and again, the systems and processes that were created did not involve the business closely enough, and these things won't scale, and in the end, there was just a tremendous amount of waste. While, of course, everyone wanted this to succeed, everyone was bought into this transformation, actually reaching its goals, everyone wants this bank to be an innovator. So through this, I realized, in kind of a similar vein to Nokia, is that project management as the principal kind of operating model and cost centers do not make you a software innovator, at least according to this and every other example of this I've seen. So again, there's something fundamentally flawed with the way that this was being tracked and measured at the business level. And reflecting on this, you know, we actually see companies like Amazon on the left who do not have Gantt charts all over the place. Instead, they've aligned their product value streams, their organizational structure with things like two pizza teams, and their software architecture with things like microservices and APIs, and have actually been able to innovate very quickly and have been able to create these disruption machines, while all these companies on the right are undergoing their Agile and DevOps transformations, but just not seeing those results. And the difference now, the disparity between the companies who figured it out and those ones that are still struggling is just getting broader and broader and actually dangerously large in the sense that retail is now almost the entire sector has been disrupted, right? But it's not just retail. Retail is just an early warning sign, just like Nokia was. So at today's rate, half of the S&P 500, one of the main US stock indices, half of the companies on it are projected to be disrupted over the next decade as companies who have figured out have become software innovators gain more and more of the market. Not even banks are immune, it turns out. So you've got cute pictures like this one. But to me, the really telling thing was a study that was published in Bloomberg in June that banks collectively have spent $1 trillion on digital transformation. So that's about 1% or over 1% of the world GDP they've spent on digital transformation, and the results are not measurable today. So this is just a fundamental problem. This amount of desire to change and improve, this amount of investment, and not being able to see a measurable result is just this fundamental problem. I realized we simply do not have the right way of looking at this and at measuring it. So I got to asking myself, has this happened before? Is this normal? Because I think for all of us who've been working in technology for our careers, this pace of change, this constant, you know, we've been hearing the word disruption for one or two decades now, and it's kind of, you know, I think we've become almost deafened to it. Is this normal? Has this happened before? Will it ever change? Or will, you know, technology stacks and the way that we deploy and manage software and the way that we use, you know, the next JavaScript framework, is the pace of change going to be this rapid? Are the tech giants going to keep replatforming everything on us? And Gene Kim introduced me to the work of Dr. Claudia Perez, who's actually based at the London School of Economics. And what's so interesting about her is that in 2002, she published this book called Technological Revolutions and Financial Capital, where she identified these five sort of long waves in the economy. You can think of them as quadratic waves, starting with the Industrial Revolution here, the age of steam and railways, age of steel and heavy engineering, age of oil and mass production, and most recently, the age of software and digital. And she noted that about every 50 years, some new means of production became cheap, and the set of new companies, these innovators, learn how to master it and scale it. So, and as soon as that happened, you had this thing called the installation period. And this is the most interesting part of our model that I think we need to take back, which is you had this installation period, we had this frenzy of startups and of capital. So call it venture capital, fueling those startups to try to make a 10x return on becoming one of the new masters of this new age of technology. Right? So if we think back just over a century, in Detroit alone, there were over 300 car startups as there was this frenzy of capital to take what Henry Ford did with mass production and production lines and become one of the, you know, the big car companies. Then that, you know, that frenzy grows and grows, and you get to the turning point where some companies get so good at manufacturing, using this new means of production at scale, that they become, you know, the new railroad barons, right? They become the new incumbents, and they disrupt what came before them. And actually, at that point, the startups start dissipating. It gets much harder for the startups to compete as you move into production capital taking over. So, you know, imagine today in consumer electronics, right, to start a new social networking company would be pretty hard because chances are that Facebook will either buy you or destroy you. Similar to how a company like Jawbone, who basically created three different new market segments of basically what we have now is AirPods, of the Bluetooth headphones, then of portable speakers and wearables, they raised over $1 billion of financial capital to be basically sold for assets. So it's just too difficult already to compete with Apple and Samsung. But where we are today is in basically going through this period of creative destruction. According to Dr. Paris and all the work I've done, we're in the midst of this turning point where some companies have become so good at managing an innovation of software at scale that they're gaining more and more of the economy. These are the FANGs and Microsoft, Baidu, Alibaba, and Tencent in China, the BATs. These companies only exist in the US and in China today. There are nine of them, and if you take their value combined, you get the size of the Japanese economy. You get the value of the third largest economy, and they're growing. So that's the amount of basically wealth they've accumulated by mastering software delivery at scale. What Dr. Paris says is that we then go through this turning point where there's technology diffusion, where other companies learn the practices of those new masters of production, and adopt them to their organizations. So this talk is really about how do we get your company from being stuck in this basically in this decline that's being pushed by either the startups, the unicorns, or the tech giants. How do we get them to participate in the tremendous wealth generation that happens in the deployment period where other companies learn how to adapt and how to build in for this age, how to become innovators in software and digital. And it probably won't be through project management, is the other thing I learned through this book. Because Dr. Paris indicates in her book that each of these revolutions has come with new innovations in management and steering models for production. So we got factory systems, then we got subcontracting, then we got Taylorism, right? In the age of steel and heavy engineering, where we had to learn how to build massive buildings and dams and bridges, we got Taylorism as a way of treating people as mindless cogs in the machine that you could basically shuffle between different construction projects and manage with a Gantt chart, which was innovated for building the Hoover Dam. That's where we got project management. But Henry Ford realized that when you're doing highly complex work, you actually can't manage people that way. You have to invest in them. You have to take some consideration for their well-being. And yet, as I was having all those meetings, I was realizing that the way that at a business level, people are being treated in IT and reassigned to projects, assigned to 10, 15 different software projects at a time, treated as completely fungible, was actually applying Taylorist principles to software delivery teams, which is not quite aligned with, I think, some of the things that we've learned through Agile. So I got to wondering, you know, how is it that other companies have made this transition? Because if we look back a century, we should be able to see, or less than a century, we should be able to see how some companies made that transition and actually became the brands that survived, that went into the deployment period. And I realized that one of those organizations was actually one of our biggest customers. And this is one of the car brands that we still do recognize, unlike the hundreds that we don't, that actually went away. And this was BMW. So I went and did this kind of, for me, it was almost like a pilgrimage in the end, this trip to the BMW's flagship plant in Leipzig. And I want to understand not just the kind of geeky lean manufacturing stuff that I do really enjoy, but how at a business level they thought about innovation and they actually managed production. And so I did this 2-day tour of the plant, and this was more eye-opening to me than any lean book I've read. I've tried to read all the books, and I thought I actually knew this stuff pretty well. It was a very different experience to see it in action, so I just want to share some of the highlights of that trip with you today. So first of all, everything about this experience was all about sort of product innovation flow and value streams. When I started looking at the plant from space, you could actually see the product value streams from the satellite imagery. This is called the hand structure because it's got kind of that thumb at the bottom and those five fingers. This is the 1 and 2 series production line. This is where the BMW 1 and 2 series are created. I walked that line. It was over 8 miles that I clocked on my watch walking this line. It's the sophistication, the complexity of it rivals any software that I've seen. So BMW is managing 30,000 suppliers. Each manufacturing step takes 70 seconds at most. That's the tack time for this plant. And every car that gets started is actually delivered because they've got pretty expensive parts. Every car is different. And it's actually delivered not only with just-in-time inventory, with trucks pulling up to the part of the production line where the parts are consumed, it's delivered just in sequence, where the order that comes in from dealerships and customers is the order in which the cars drive off the plant. So this bit ballet of complexity was just tremendous. But what was most surprising to me was that the i8 line, that fancy looking, basically yesterday's car of the future, which I still think is pretty cool looking, was only the width of that building. So it was only, five times the width of this hall, four times the width of this hall. Every manufacturing step took 30 minutes. And I thought, well, this is so strange. This is their most complex and fancy car, right? This is their answer to Tesla. And learning how to basically create these hybrid and electrical vehicles. And what it turns out is that BMW thinks very differently about very different product value streams. So whereas the 1 and 2 series product value stream and that line is all around making BMW's top line, the i8 was really all about learning how to manufacture electric vehicles. They've actually ended the program. I think it was about a month ago that they ended the program because they've now done that learning. So it's optimized for learning, not for revenue and top line. And the way that it was created and managed was completely different, the whole different set of business constraints. So I really got to thinking, why is this so different than the way I'm seeing at a business level organizations think about enterprise IT and innovation? And the thing that really struck me was just the way that BMW thinks about and manages innovation through lean principles. And this embodiment, these are just the lean principles straight out of Jim Womack's book, but they are precise. The number one, the first one is precisely specify value by product. Identify the value stream for each product, make value flow without interruptions, and let the customer pull value from the producer. And everything about the plant, the culture, the people, their language, the posters on the wall, was all about these lean principles. And I just realized how starkly, there was not a single Gantt chart in sight, not that BMW doesn't use project management, because they do. They have multiple projects going on. One of the biggest ones right now, they were talking about Brexit. That's a very massive project for them, as their supply chain shifts and needs to adapt, right? They've got projects for setting up new plants. They've got projects for modernizing parts of delivery. But the way that they track delivery and innovation is through these product value streams that are designed around customer flow, which again is a very different way of measuring. So when I got to thinking, to contrasting what happens in car production versus enterprise IT, everything is around these integrated production lines, not these disconnected tool chains. Basically, what I was seeing in organizations would be to them equivalent to someone taking off a bucket of parts and throwing it from the business to manufacturing and expecting to get something back tomorrow, right? It would be completely foreign to them. Everything, the organizing principle, everything is managed and tracked around products, not around projects. Projects are, again, for these new launches, initiatives, plants, and so on. You track production through the flow on products. Everything's architected around flow. So you can have redundancies in different lines if that increases your flow from an architectural point of view. Whereas what I was seeing in enterprise architectures, and a lot of my PhD is actually in software architecture, is these massive, perfect, enterprise architectures that meet every business scenario, rather than, again, being focused on maximizing flow for this one particular product value stream. everything at the plant is optimized end-to-end, because BMW, like every car manufacturer knows, that lead time, the time from customer order to delivered car, is the number one predictor of their performance. Whereas what they would see us doing is optimizing in silos, right? Code commit to code deploy, that's a proxy metric. That has nothing to do with value for your customer, for the business. User story open to user story close, another proxy metric for a segment of the value stream. All of their top-level metrics are end-to-end flow metrics. And of course, if they have a bottleneck, then they dive in to those different proxy metrics. And everything's geared around measuring business results rather than, again, measuring and claiming value from these proxy metrics. So the core question that the flow framework attempts to answer is what flows in software delivery? For BMW, it's pretty simple. It's cars that deliver sheer driving pleasure. So if you imagine now your organization, your set of teams, and the information that's flowing in those teams to your customers, what's actually flowing? What is the unit of production that we're after? Because we know it's not lines of code. We know it's not chain success rate. What's value from the point of view of pull of our customers? And the flow framework only has four flow items that encapsulate all value delivered in all your product value streams. So features, that's new business value. That's what's going to basically have your customers, your business partners, determine whether to use your solution or another solution. The more features are in it, the more likely it's gonna get selected, the more innovative it is. Defects, any sufficiently complex system has defects. Cars have today have tens of thousands of defects, hopefully usually low priority ones, so they don't stop on you on the highway. But the more defects you can fix, the more instances you can address more quickly, the more innovative you become. This is why, of course, tech giants focus more on mean time to resolution rather than mean time to failure. Risks, this one, by the way, started as security, but John Smart had a long conversation with me how there's a big, and he'll be speaking this afternoon, how there's a bigger bucket of risks that we really need to make first class in software delivery. So that's security, it's also availability and compliance, governance, data privacy, and so on, and debts, technical debt, infrastructure debt, value stream debt. So these four flow items represent all work that's done. They layer on above any scaling, any scaled agile framework, DAD, Nexus, Scrum principles that you use. Any work items map into these four, and these four things at a business level are MISI. They're mutually exclusive and comprehensively exhaustive, which means you do more of one, you do less of another. You have your teams implement GDPR, you basically spend 6 months on GDPR, as some of you may have, as we did with our teams, you're going to get fewer features, right? You can't ask for more of both at the same time because these are all trade-offs, and these are trade-offs that we need to understand at a business level. So let me illustrate this. When I was first putting these slides together, Gene said, you know, Mick, you're gonna be showing this to executives. All executives understand there's up and down arrows, so you have to show the flow framework with up and down arrows, and that's it. So here's the flow framework with up and down arrows. So, that's the most important arrow. So because our products truly are going to succeed or fail on the features that we put into them. The more features we can put in, the more successful they'll be, the more relevant you'll be, and comparable you'll be to that, you know, that fintech, insurtech, or whatever other startup you're worrying about. But as that happens, debts and risks rise. Because again, this is a zero-sum game. Quality goes down and defect work goes up. And then too easily, value streams find themselves in the exact same situation as Nokia did, where defect work starts taking the entire capacity of a product value stream. Everyone on the business side is all upset why they're getting no features. Feature delivery has gone basically down to zero. And no one quite understands why, except of course the people working on the software who know exactly what's happened, which is that technical debt's gone to the point they can't actually implement new features. And they knew this all along, incidentally. So here's another look at it from a business leader who actually did understand these trade-offs. So this was an event that was just fascinating to me. This is back in 2003. Bill Gates released this really weird, at least at that time, seemingly weird memo, who said, it was the trustworthy computing memo, and he said, okay, at Microsoft, we're gonna stop all feature work and focus on reducing tech debt and improving security, which is a pretty crazy, basically no other CEO, I think, to that point or potentially to now of any enterprise organization said, is stop all feature work across all product value streams, reduce tech debt. But they did that, and they realized how important security was going to be before it was front page news with all the breaches that we see today. Focused across Microsoft's product value streams on tech debt reduction, debts and risks went down. They actually made their pile of legacy, which I believe is the largest pile of legacy stuff on the planet, because they literally started the age of software, So they have more legacy than anybody, by definition. Address that incrementally across this massively broad portfolio, and now have actually created the most valuable company, public company on the planet. So by replatforming, by investing, they've also done different moves. There have been times where Bill Gates took on massive piles of technical debt, say by implementing the Internet Explorer and pushing all that technical debt into our organization in the process, because he had to play disruption defense against Netscape. So the goal of the Flow framework is to give our business leaders visibility to the dynamics of basically of technology and these trade-offs, and allow our organizations to make these decisions, to get onto the same page, not to have them understand the details of story points or chain success rate, but to actually understand the details of production and flow and software delivery. The way it works is you basically define your product value streams. And this is an important, not an easy exercise. It's basically an architecture exercise where you define from the business and the customer point of view what the product value streams are for internal and external customers. I'll get back to the internal customers in a moment. And then for each of those product value streams, you track flow metrics. So basically what's flowing, and then how that impacts business results. So I'll go through each of the flow metrics with flow velocity, how much of each flow item get done, flow efficiency, the ratio of wait states to active work states, flow time, how long it takes from the customer's point of view, and flow load, how much load you've introduced into your product value streams. And then you correlate those to business results. So did getting more features done increase our revenue or conversion? If it was an internal product value stream, did it increase the adoption of the new API we created for several business products? The cost, but it's the end-to-end cost of the value stream, not the cost of development or testing and operations, the end-to-end cost, including hosting costs of your value streams, the quality, and then the happiness of the staff working on the product value stream. We know tangled architectures, for example, make developers miserable because they can't deliver features, and they're actually more likely to quit. You will get a leading indicator in their happiness scores, as we've learned. So I'll give you a few really quick examples. So this is one of the customers that we worked on. This Nationwide Insurance showed this a year ago at the DevOps Enterprise Summit. We measured how long it took the flow time from basically some business requirement or feature need to running software. And it took about 120 days. And so the CIO said, OK, well, this is, you know, not great. You know, the insurtech startups can do this much faster than us. Let's hire a lot more developers because we need to move faster, which is a pretty typical response. Then we measured how that flow time was decomposed, and it turned out that on average, 2.5% of the time was spent in development. So you hire twice as many developers, which is not usually the easiest thing to do, but you hire twice as many developers and nothing's moving any faster. The upfront wait states on the business and the downstream wait states on things like security review were taking most of the time. So again, if you're not investing in where the constraint, where the bottleneck is, you're not getting anything more out, which is what all these organizations are doing today. By not having visibility into this and by only measuring how long it takes for user story open to deployed software, which is 2.5 days out of, in this case, 120, or 3 days out of 120. So by measuring flow time, basically starting the flow time clock when work enters the value stream and stopping that clock when you've got running software, you actually get visibility into this. Then we next looked at where's the feature delivery bottleneck? And in their case, for some of the key value streams, so they wanted more of that innovation, more of those innovative screens and mobile apps, it was actually upfront wait states. It wasn't even the DevOps where we expected to be more on the CI/CD automation. It was actually waiting on UX design in these key value streams because they had about one designer for approximately 100 developers. You look at what it takes to make a modern user experience, it's more like one to a dozen now, if you look at companies like Atlassian or, in this case, Box and IBM. So flow efficiency shows you that. It shows you where the wait states are because they're not always obvious, and they will differ between different product value streams. Next, why is delivery slowing as we add more developers? And this is the number one reason I'm seeing as we deploy the flow framework in various organizations is the software architecture is not aligned to the product value streams. The product value streams were never defined properly, and so these things are misaligned, and you basically have these constant wait states from an underinvestment in shared services, shared APIs, and so on. Because there's been such an over-focus on the external business-facing product value streams rather than the ones that support them. You look at a company like a Google or a tech giant, their investment in platforms and APIs, data services, analytics pipelines, tends to be larger than their business application because that powers their business applications, right? BMW's most important product is not the 3 Series or the i8, it's the plant. And so actually looking at flow efficiency and flow velocity will allow you to uncover that and make a business case for investing more into the core products. Why are the developers working on this less happy? So tech debt is causing overly high flow loads, a typical answer, and frustration. And again, if you can actually measure that, you'll see the need to invest in, say, tech debt reduction. And not this knee-jerk, oh, we need to do 20% tech debt, but the actual tech debt reduction needed to get a faster feature flow in the future. So I'll wrap up quickly right now, but basically, by exposing this entire dynamic system, and this is one of our examples, here we saw a flow load spike the first time this product went public. This is one of our new products, because what happens is we want to get all these features out the door, and that immediately turned into a flow time spike. We were basically 10 times slower delivering those features. We got a lot less done for release. The differences that we saw, we were able to adjust. We realized that we needed more developers on this product value stream and more other specialists on this product value stream, and we invested. But the key thing was that all of this was visible. The similar way how this product value stream over here, they were able to basically double their flow velocity by investing in tech debt reduction, because any architecture worker tech debt reduction should turn into faster feature flow. Otherwise, why are you doing it? So we don't actually invest in architecture, in any enablers or tech debt, unless we think it'll give us a faster feature flow within 12 months. Otherwise, we're probably over-architecting. All right, so just to quickly summarize, the whole goal is you move to this end-to-end flow orientation across your organization. You've got direct visibility on your product value streams rather than doing this through project management. You're actually able to budget and invest per value streams and do so incrementally. And of course, you're bringing work to people rather than bringing people to work. And your architecture starts being aligned to these product value streams. So the whole goal here is that we move away from projects and cost centers to product value streams, silos and proxy metrics, to flow metrics and business results, and fragmented value streams to this integrated value stream network. So with that, I'll wrap up. I'll be signing the book. There's more in the book. And all the proceeds of the book go to programs supporting women minorities in technology. So thank you very much.